program administrator with the Consumer Supports Bureau at the Agency for Persons with Disabilities State Office in Tallahassee. Welcome to this session. And with me today is not Amanda Sewell. I think the program said it was Amanda Sewell, and she was not able to make it. But who better than the Regional Operations Manager for the Central Region?
Woo-hoo. Hey, everyone.
Janet Estes is here with us, and I'm super excited to be able to co-present with her. We do have some handouts. There are some in the back, and I have some in here. If you raise your hand, I'll be happy to get to you. Okay, you're welcome. Okay, so one for you and one for you. How about that? And then we have some more back there if anybody needs one. Thank you so much for coming today. The main purpose of today's presentation is to talk about APD's eligibility criteria, the application and intake process. And we're going to talk to you also about how to get on our waiting list. Talk about the waiting list, which I know it's not something we like to talk about, but it is. That I was trying to come up with the right word. But unfortunately, we have to live with a waiting list, and we'll talk about it in just a few moments. We'll also tell you a little bit about what are the options and how can somebody enroll on the iBudget waiver the way we're operating right now. And there's a list of ways a person can enroll on the waiver. And we'll tell you a little bit about our iBudget Home and Community-Based Services waiver. And so to begin, our APD application for services is found on our website at apdcares.org. You click on customers and scroll down to the application section. The application is available in English, in Spanish, and in Haitian Creole. At the moment, we're not able to fill it in online, but you can print it, fill it in, and send it in either by mail, fax, or turn it in person at the local office in the region that you reside in. The application is divided in several different sections, some of which you fill out, and some of them are filled out by the regional staff once they have verified certain information. But I do want to say that eventually we will have the application in our iConnect system. So anybody that's going to be rolled out in one of the future rollouts of our iConnect system, which is our client data management system, it's just not, we're not there yet, but we have plans. And an application may be accepted from a parent or a court-appointed guardian of a minor child, a legally competent adult, and an authorized legal representative. So for adults who have a court order or a court document indicating who their legal representative is, that's the individual who is authorized to sign the application. For children under the age of 18, the application must be signed by their parents. The applications are submitted to the APD office.
So applications are going to be submitted to the APD office in your area. And actually, let me just say here, we don't have our map up, but if you go to our website, apdcares.org, very important website, I would encourage you to write that down, apdcares with an s.org. Our agency structure, we are divided into regions, six regions. The Northwest, which is headquartered out of Tallahassee, the Northeast, which is headquartered out of Jacksonville, Central, which is shameless plug here, the best, Orlando. Just kidding, if you live somewhere else, of course, they're the best as well. And then Suncoast, which is Tampa, Southeast, which is West Palm, and then the Southern region, which is Miami-Dade. So depending on where you live in the state, you will go to our website, as Liesl mentioned earlier. You'll get that application online. It does have to be printed, and you do need that back to your respective office via regular mail.
Yeah.
I'd hate to call it snail mail, but that's what we call it nowadays, or hand delivery. If we will take an application via fax, but we have to have an original signature, and that's for people's identification protection, so we do need to have that. And as I mentioned earlier,
APDcares.org, but when you click on it, that's what you see.
Okay.
But you have to type in APDcares.org.
Right. Okay. And it'll pull, if you look on, when you get to APDcares.org, it pulls up our website. There's a nice little tab, different tabs. You can click on locations, and there'll be a drop-down box with the different regions that I just named. On the next slide, we're going to talk about the actual application eligibility determination process. And just kind of segueing off of what Liesl was mentioning earlier, anyone who's 18 years or older, because they're an adult, has to sign their application unless they've been determined legally incompetent or incapacitated by a court of competent jurisdiction in this state. That means they have a legally ordered guardian, and then the guardian will have to sign. If for some reason we have a person that may still be legally competent, but they're for some reason unable to actually write their signature, maybe I don't have a guardian, but I just can't physically sign, I need to be able to just make a mark, and whoever's with that person in the circle of supports, help them make the mark, and then we just want to write a little statement, this is the person's mark, so we know that that's their signature. And then continuing in this line of discussion, once we get the receipt of the completed, meaning all the boxes checked, all the blanks filled out, and the signed application, we're going to look at that application to see, is everything checked, completed, signed, and then we're going to look to see what information you all have submitted with that application to make a determination of eligibility. And of course, we hope and pray that it's complete, like you want it to be as well, because we would love to make a decision right away as quickly as possible. Unfortunately, that's usually the exception rather than the norm, and that's nobody's fault. It's just part of the process. And if we do determine that we need additional information known as collateral documentation, or collateral, that's kind of a big word, I always have to think, what does that mean? That means outside information that's going to support your quest and your argument that says this person has a developmental disability. And I think Liesl's going to talk about a little bit what types of those documentation pieces would be here in just a second.
So these are some of the examples of the types of documentation that we will need. As part of the review of the entire package, we need documentation that shows that the individual has a developmental disability as defined in our rules. But to begin, for starters, we need to have a diagnostic documentation, which sometimes can be provided by a clinical psychologist or a medical doctor or a doctor of osteopathy. And we'll go over those details in future slides. But right now, these are just some of the examples of the types of documentation that we will need. So standardized IQ tests. And examples of those are like the Stanford-Binet, the Wechsler tests, and there are Wechsler for preschool, Wechsler for children up to the age of 15. There's different types of Wechslers. There's also one for adults, and there's different type of IQ tests. We will need also, as an example for some of our developmental disabilities, we'll need a test of adaptive functioning. An example of those are the Vineland, the Adaptive Behavior Assessment, the known as the ABAS, or there's also an ABES. Anyway, so you probably, if you're applying for services, You may already have one of those tests. If you don't, our agency should be able to pay for one to definitively tell whether or not the applicant has a developmental disability. So what we're looking for is an individual who has a developmental disability as diagnosed prior to the age of 18. It's not uncommon for us to receive applications from individuals who are in their 40s or 50s because they've been in their homes being taken care of all their lives by their parents, but now, you know, parents need help. So they may have tests from prior to the age of 18 at that point. So while they may be over 20 years old, it's okay.
But I would say, as a rule of thumb, just to add on a little bit, the more recent, the more recent, the better. Obviously, if they're older, we're gonna. Mm-hmm. But the rule is, we need the manifestation. We need something that shows the manifestation of that disability prior to 18. And if you've got a test that says that, we are definitely gonna take a look at that and consider it in our review.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Yes.
I'm a little bit confused, and I don't want to confuse everybody. But my children are all under the age of 15. My son has been on the waiting list. I did him at the age of 3. Can we still fill out applications for children when they're younger? I mean, I was encouraged to
We're gonna talk about the eligibility criteria in just one or two more slides.
Okay.
And one of the criteria, but that's a good question.
Okay.
One of the criteria is that they're at least 3 years of age.
Mm-hmm.
Because children under the age of 3 are served by another state agency.
Yes.
Yes.
You had mentioned that if paperwork is missing, that the family will receive a message saying that they need to still submit this. If there's if everything's good and everything's in place, will they receive a message saying, hey, this is good now that here you are on the waiting list, or is there
yes,
any communication that
yeah, we'll get to that in a minute.
Okay.
You guys have good questions.
That's awesome.
You are, we're done here. It's a lot of work is done there to know it.
Thank you.
Yeah,
and
there was another
question.
That is part of the documentation that we will look at, but we may need some diagnostic specific information. But we'll talk about that. So other types of evaluations that we will look at are diagnostic evaluations from licensed professionals, depending on the type of diagnosis, documentation from a medical doctor or healthcare professional, genetic type of testing, because some of our disabilities require genetic testing, school records, psychological evaluations, etc.
You have a question?
Yeah. You can request to be put on this at birth, correct? If you have a child with Down syndrome, because you have, I mean, they put my son on it at birth. They applied for it. The doctor did.
For the Agency for Persons with Disabilities, it is one of the eligibility criteria required in statute is that the child is at least 3 years of age.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So, yes. Yeah. I think we're still talking about the types of documentation that we will be reviewing. For purposes of identity information, we will need a birth certificate or a resident alien card, a state driver's license or a state issued ID, a military dependent ID issued card, the original social security card, we will need to see that. We may also get the passport, the U.S. passport, or certificate of naturalization, certificate of citizenship, or school photo ID for children under the age of 16.
But some of the average one went that way. My kid's 4. You know, he's got a social. For sure, you don't have a driver's license.
No. You don't need to provide all of them.
Okay.
You provide for children. You will need to provide the birth certificate.
But
for example,
does include but are not limited to.
Right.
Includes all of these, but possibly more. So that's just the way I read that, and I just want to make sure that, because I'm pretty sure I don't know where to give them an ID.
Yeah,
no,
for children,
you
don't need to.
Is that for children or parents and the children?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you're married, you ask for the
need to see the original, so at some point you will either need to go into the office and open right now. Our offices are open, 8 to 5.
Okay, but not mail it with that.
No.
Yeah, don't mail.
Please don't mail it. Please don't mail your originals.
So 10 stamps and then when you have an appointment.
Yeah.
Third question, we'll actually speak to clarification. This is for the person in need. This is not for the parent or guardian.
Correct, it's for the applicant. Yes, it's for the applicant.
That's what I thought.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, I know what you meant.
Okay. Okay, so this is still me. We will notify the applicant within 45 days for children under the age of 6, 60 days or 90, 60 days for individuals over the age of 6, or 90 days if we need additional information of a determination of their eligibility for APD services. And at that point, we will also notify in writing if you have met the level of care criteria for waiver enrollment, you will be assigned a waiting list category. So remember, not everyone goes on the waiting list. So we have to look at the determination that the person meets the criteria for waiver enrollment. And if they do meet that criteria, then they go on the waiting list for the waiver. So individuals, there may be in some cases, and these are very few cases, where the person may meet the eligibility criteria for APD services and maybe not meet the criteria, the level of care criteria for waiver enrollment. They won't be placed on the waiting list, but they will be a client of APD and may be able to receive services through other funding mechanisms. But that's really just the, that's not the rule. For the most part, if you meet the eligibility for APD services, you're also going to meet it for the waiver.
So to be eligible for our services, three things have to happen. The person has to be at least 3 years of age, as we mentioned earlier. They have to be a resident of and domiciled in the state of Florida. That means they're living here. This is their domicile. And then have a confirmed diagnosis of a developmental disability as defined in rule and statute. Our governing statute that governs all of the agencies for persons with disabilities is Florida Statute 393. So if you ever just love to do legal research, and as a lawyer, okay, I like to do that, but you might not like to. But just if you're curious, you can look up Online Sunshine and type in Florida Statute 393, and that's the entire statute with all our sections that govern us. And then the agency, as with all government agencies, we're giving rulemaking authority out of that statute, and our rules regarding this section of what we do are found in the Florida Administrative Code, and those are the citations, 65G-4.014. One note about domicile. What does domicile mean? Circling back to that means that the person lives here. Sometimes we have applicants whose guardians live here, the legal guardians live here, but the person for some reason is still out of state. Those persons that are the guardians are deemed by the court to stand in the shoes of the ward, the person that they're the guardian for. So we technically, if that person is going to be transitioning to Florida, we will take an application for that person while they're transitioning, and we will look at that. But otherwise, the person needs to be domiciled here in the state. One common misconception that happens, and we get calls daily about this, is as you all know, that this is the greatest state in the union because everybody in the country is trying to move here right now. And so we get calls daily in all of our offices about people who are receiving services in other states from that state that they live in's waiver, and they have the expectation. I can't say that I would expect that if I lived somewhere else. Hey, I'm moving down, I want to transfer to you know, your program, I have this loved one and they have a disability. But unfortunately, because it's a Medicaid program, Medicaid does not transfer state to state. It doesn't work that way. So when they come here, we tell them, don't do it. Stay up there, we have a waiting list, you know. But of course they can come if they choose to, but they're gonna have to do what everybody else does that comes here and is already living here, and they're gonna have to go through the application intake and eligibility process, and 99% get put onto the waiting list. So it doesn't transfer state to state, and we do have the established process. So
does the applicant need to be on Medicaid?
In Florida or just generally?
Florida.
once we determine, as part of our eligibility process, we have staff called Human Service Counselor Threes, waitlist counselors, as Liesl mentioned earlier, for short. They work with the families and the Department of Children and Families, who actually, as I'm sure everybody in this room probably already knows this, do the actual determination for Medicaid for the programming for our iBudget waiver, which is the Medicaid waiver. So we will work with the DCF person and the family to get that part done and into the system.
My son's 35 years old, and we're in the military, so we've been on this across many different states. He's never been on Medicaid.
You're in the military?
I retired.
Okay.
He's never been on Medicaid because we got Medicare at age 20 when he applied for SSI and was automatically enrolled in Medicare. And as everybody knows, the doctor choices with Medicare are much more robust than they are with Medicaid.
Yeah.
So we have never gotten him on Medicaid. So in order to apply for APD, we will have to, I guess, have him apply for Medicaid.
You can apply for APD without having Medicaid. The only time you will need Medicaid is when you've been approved for waiver enrollment through one of the enrollment mechanisms. So
yeah, but we were denied for two reasons. Number one, we weren't on Medicaid. And number two, despite our best efforts, we don't have a document that says he has autism before the age of 18.
Yeah.
However, we submitted 385 pages of medical records from clinical encounters that have gone from 22 to the current date that dictate that this psychiatrist is saying onset of autism 2.5. Apparently, that's not acceptable.
Was that here in our state?
Yes.
Where do you live?
We live in Deerfield Beach in Broward County.
Okay. Can I talk to you after so we can discuss a little bit more specifically about your needs?
Thank you, sir.
Okay, I'll see you after.
I just piggyback off that. I get a lot of calls with all the documentation that people need to prove autism, like every single IEP they've ever been to in their school system, stuff like that. So maybe comments at some point were appropriate on why people are looking more closely at these exact diagnoses and
two questions.
That's a perfect segue because Liz is going to talk in more in depth about autism in a few slides and
yeah.
about that. So, Jim.
Yeah, before you jump, I just want to go back to what this person said. That he said that everybody kind of knows about the study. That might be fine, but I don't.
Oh, that was my little talk. I was just trying to be.
No, that's fine. But this person I heard about, so this Medicaid thing, and he said it has to be applied through
DCF.
Yeah.
So this is something I still should also be doing for my child. I have never heard about this. That's why I'm here.
Is your child on the waiting list?
No, that's why I'm also here.
Oh, okay. So once you can apply for APD services, you do not need to apply right now for Medicaid. Yes.
You can.
But I could do it simultaneously.
You can. Absolutely.
But it's not a requirement.
Right.
And it's done through DCF.
It's done through DCF.
I don't know the benefit. I don't know anything about it, but I'll look into that. Okay. That's all I wanted to clarify.
Step one would be apply for APD. Once you're determined eligible for APD services, you're on the waiting list, then, you know, my recommendation is that then you start looking into Medicaid.
Yes.
Now, that's not a requirement to be on the waiting list.
That's what I was clarifying. Yes. And I'm sort of related to the DCF part that I just did. How do you even do it? I don't even know what it is.
But once a person is going to be moved from the waiting list to waiver, I'm sorry, I probably caused confusion with my explanation. Once a person's number comes up, not a number, but they're determined, hey, it's time for them to move from the wait list to our waiver, they do have to have Medicaid.
Yeah.
So that's why we was encouraging.
Okay, I got plenty of time.
Yes. Well, maybe. You never know how soon that might happen.
You never know. There is no way to predict how long a person is going to be on the waiting list from the time they're determined to be eligible and go on the waiting list to the time they begin receiving services. We're going to talk about the different possibilities of how someone can go on the waiver. For some people, it's less time. For some people, it may be more. But it's not like you apply first, you go first. It's not done in that order. It's by need. Yes.
So the Medicaid.
I believe there is a way, a period of redetermination, of eligibility redetermination for Medicaid, because now I don't work for DCF.
Currently there's not. I'm on the waiver.
Okay.
Currently there's not, but I didn't know if as an elderly person in his 50s, they could still go into qualify for Medicaid.
part, I would say yes.
Yeah, there's an annual redetermination that DCF, and we have staff, there's like a liaison in each region. We work with, and it's up to the waiver support coordinator. We're kind of getting a little ahead here, but just to answer your question, the person will have a waiver support coordinator who will work with DCF to make sure that the Medicaid continues. The eligibility is.
And can Medicaid end, like he said, he has Medicare, can we do an A and a B, like if I have a secondary insurance, can I back up in for better care?
If you make the entitlement programs, you're.
And I can cover my son for, like, on my private healthcare commercial insurance.
Yes, you can. But I will tell you that Medicaid is the favorite of last resort, regardless of which program. And ACA, and I don't know if we have an ACA, but they'll tell you. Right.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think we're on the next step of the.
We're on slide 12, if you're following the slides. So, a developmental disability as defined in statute means a disorder or syndrome that is attributable to an intellectual disability with an IQ of 70 or below, cerebral palsy, mostly severe forms of autism, spina bifida cystica, and I don't know how to pronounce that. Down syndrome, Phelan-McDermid syndrome, and Prader-Willi syndrome. And according to our statute, it must manifest itself prior to the age of 18, and it will constitute a substantial handicap that can reasonably be expected to continue indefinitely. I know some of you ask, so what if we don't have documentation prior to the age of 18? And that is a question that we receive all the time. We have individuals in each region that will review the applications. Sometimes it's easier than other times to be able to tell the likelihood that the individual had the, that the onset of the disability occurred prior to the age of 18. In specific cases, and I know you will be talking to the gentleman over here, you know, for whatever reason it gets denied. You always have a hearing process. You can challenge the decision and you can go to, you know, and to a hearing and expose your points. And that's always your right. You need to know that you can do that. You have a certain period of time from the time you receive the notice of ineligibility to request that hearing. But our advice is always make use of that. That is a right, and you need to go ahead and take care of that. So.
What you jump up that, I've never seen something, what does it really mean by this autism severe forms? Is there any, are you gonna get to that later, there's more?
There's like some real specific criteria, and I will go over some of them.
Okay, thank you.
I'll go over some of that without having to read the entire rule for you. But the rule is a document that's also available online, and anyone can, you know.
Well, I just wanna know that when I go to another doctor appointment, that I'll have some of that information with me.
Absolutely.
I didn't see anything, I don't recall seeing anything in these documents that was more specific than autism. I don't recall seeing that, even though that's what the diagnosis says, so.
So for intellectual disability, the way it is defined in our rule is significantly subaverage general intellectual functioning with significant deficits in adaptive functioning, which manifests before the age of 18 and can reasonably be expected to continue indefinitely. So we will have to look for documentation that clearly indicates that this criteria is found in the documentation. We will be looking for a full scale of an IQ of 70 or below, and adaptive tests from licensed psychologists. I don't want to confuse this issue, but in order for a person to be eligible to enroll on the waiver, our waiver criteria is set in an agreement called a waiver document that we have with the federal government. It indicates that individuals must have, if they're enrolling with a diagnosis of intellectual disability, it has to be an IQ of 69 or less. So this is why I was saying
it may be possible for somebody to meet APD's eligibility criteria with an IQ of 70, who may not necessarily meet the waiver criteria, which requires an IQ of 69 or below. I know this is real technical, but you need to know this. Because, you know, when you come to apply, I know that the entire process can be very difficult, and it can be very confusing. We hear that all the time from parents. So it's important that you know this.
Well, the issue that I take with saying it should be below 70 or it should be 69 or less is that within all IQ tests, all the ones that you've mentioned, there's something known as confidence level.
Mm-hmm.
This is a very, very strong statistical concept, which means that on any given day, this person could have been 2 points above or 2 points below your actual score. How is it that you say it must be a cutoff at 69? It kind of defies mathematics, science, and what's commonly being used in the medical industry. Why is that the case?
So I understand that, but I also know that in order for the agency to be able to provide services, we need to be able to set some clear guidance. And what you said is absolutely correct. I'm not saying that that's not right. But when we look at an IQ, we're also looking at the adaptive tests. We're also looking at everything else. We also are looking to whether or not it can reasonably, you know, there's documentation in there that indicates that it can reasonably be expected to last for a very long time or indefinitely. We're looking at the educational records. We will look at what was written in the IEP, because a lot of times, you know, there's going to be additional information in the IEP. We look at the totality of the information, but we have to start somewhere. And so we have that, but when the regions get back with you and say, we're not real sure because it's IQ 71, can you please provide us with school records? Anything else that will help us determine exactly what you said. On that day, the person scored a 71, but you know, there may be additional information that will tell us this person really, and then to add to that, sometimes we receive multiple evaluations, psychological tests, and one says 71, one says 67. So that's why I'm saying we need to look at the totality of the documentation. We can't just look at one piece of document and say yes. Although sometimes we can. But in situations like this, when it's really borderline, we really, really need to look at everything. Yes, ma'am.
I'm just piggybacking. So you're saying that you do not take into account standard deviation?
Yes, we do.
Oh.
Yeah, actually, when you look at our statute says it's with two standard deviations, and that's how it gets to 70. One standard deviation being 15 points, two being 30.
She meant standard error.
Sir?
She meant standard error, not standard deviation.
Okay.
She's the wrong word.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. But
me afterwards.
Yeah, she was just answering for standard deviation. She didn't stand. So you don't make allowances for standard deviation.
Yes, we do. That's why I'm saying we need to look at the totality. We need to look at all the documents that you have that you can possibly submit that will be able to show the likelihood of you know, the person having less than that IQ. Yes. So the IQ test must be performed by professionals who are licensed clinical psychologists.
So they do it, and you're doing it privately. Are you going to be able to review the test before we submit the test?
Well, that's the whole thing, is we review what you submit to us.
So we
you
have that child tested 5 times.
Yeah.
So he said he just marked them all, he found where he did it wrong or did it right, in error. We can retest that child or the person.
Whatever you submit us, we're going to look at.
Okay, so yeah, it's just an off day.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes.
So I have a question. In the psychoeducational evaluation from the school ESE department, district office, is that acceptable when it gives an IQ or a doctor's
we will look at it as part of the whole record.
Was it done through an IQ test?
Yes.
And do you have the IQ test? And do you have the IQ test that derived that?
It says, right, and there is a readout, a final readout, that every child should go through a comprehensive reading eval in the ESC department every 3 years, or you can ask for it too.
Yeah, every piece of document that you have, we will look at.
It has to, actually, I'm asking, there are designated tests that are accepted under our rule criteria, and it has to be one of.
Right.
It has to be Stanford, Binet, the Wexler, the differentiability skills.
Like, they're specifically mentioned in our.
So they administer, they're listed in our rule criteria 65G-4, so we've listed all those acceptable tests out.
Can that be added to your?
Yeah, I think you, it's in there, right?
No, these are, I got that in mind.
Okay.
Oh, but the rule is in there.
65G-4, it's, those tests are specifically listed in there that are accepted.
I can ask if the neuropsych has to be higher to be the higher question.
So for intellectual. I don't think you have to hire a neuropsych for these tests.
And or if a school psychologist does the test.
Right.
As long as it's a test that's approved by.
By the.
By our rule criteria. Okay.
So the professionals have these tests, and they perform these tests with the individual. What we do is we will review the information.
Well, I was wondering if specific testing is listening to you, as often as super.
That can be, absolutely, and we have it in our rule, and yes.
And they're pretty much standard.
They are standard.
So if you have a reputable, how do we, they are probably going to be on the.
What was your question, ma'am? You've been patient.
I was just saying, you know, to piggyback on what these people were saying, that, you know, when my daughter qualified, she had kind of like a range. Her range was, I think, between the IQ of 68 and 70, and they accepted that. So, you know, it's not specifically that, it was just, you know, she scored this on one test, she scored that on one test, and it seemed kind of like they took all of that into account. So, yeah.
Dangerous territory back here.
Okay, we're going to talk about cerebral palsy. And in our rule criteria, we've spelled out here for you what our rule defines as cerebral palsy: a group of disabling symptoms of extended duration that are resulting from damage to the developing brain, resulting in loss or impairment of control over voluntary muscles. It does not specifically include these symptoms that are related just to a stroke. Related, but not just to a stroke, specific to a stroke. A diagnosis is confirmed by medical records, and again, as we said earlier, manifestation prior to the age of 18. The evidence or the documentation that we're going to look for this disability is from either a medical doctor, a doctor of osteopathy, or other medical records that, again, document this disability that manifests prior to the age of 18. Did you have a question?
Yeah, you just read off what non-accidental brain injury is. But yet, your non-accidental brain injury is not one of your diagnoses. So I had to go to the trouble to get my kid diagnosed with CP because he's a shaken baby. And I mean, that goes back to your diagnoses. Some of your diagnoses really are crazy. I'm trying to figure out where they got them from, but what you just read, if I would not have seen it, was cerebral palsy. That's a non-accidental brain injury.
Well, again, you can give us the documentation, we will review it against our criteria.
Oh, I just went and got a diagnosis of CP. You know, why not? We already have 8 other diagnoses.
And that's a good point that you're bringing up.
Yeah.
So sometimes, you know, an individual may have a different diagnosis, but it resulted also in him or her having cerebral palsy, or him or her having intellectual disability. So you know, he will become eligible under the intellectual disability or the cerebral palsy. And that's perfectly understandable. All right, so for. All right, so for autism, and we get asked this question a lot. And, you know, we do have a limited amount of time in this presentation. But I do know that there are always a lot of questions about autism. An individual who wants to become eligible or is applying for eligibility through autism, first and foremost, will need to come with a diagnosis of autism. But a diagnosis of autism through the DSM is not all that we will need. Our rule requires that in addition to having a diagnosis of autism, the person has additional characteristics. So first, for our rule purposes, autism means a pervasive, neurologically based developmental disability of extended duration, which causes severe learning, communication, and behavior disorders with age of onset during infancy and childhood. Individuals with autism exhibit impairments in reciprocal social interactions, impairments in verbal and nonverbal communication, and imaginative ability, and a markedly restricted repertoire of activities and interests. A diagnosis of autism may be made by a licensed psychiatrist, psychologist, neurologist, or developmental pediatrician who have specific training and experience in making such diagnosis. Now, pursuant to our rule, autism means a condition which meets the requirements of our statute in 393. Again, that's pervasive, neurologically based, a developmental disability with extended duration that causes severe learning disorders. But autism must also be characterized by an individual evidencing six of the following. So severe communication disorders, which include a delay in or total lack of the development of spoken language. A stereotyped and repetitive use of language or idiosyncratic language. For those applicants with speech, marked impairment in the use of multiple nonverbal behaviors such as eye-to-eye gaze, facial expression, body postures, and gestures to regulate social interactions, failure to develop peer relationships, a lack of spontaneous seeking to share enjoyment, interest, or achievements with other people, lack of social or emotional reciprocity, and marked impairment in the ability to initiate or sustain a conversation with others, impaired imaginative ability evidenced by a lack of very spontaneous make-believe play or social imitative play, and then the severe behavior disorders, which are restricted, repetitive, and stereotype patterns of behavior, interests, and activities that include encompassing preoccupation with one or more stereotyped and restricted patterns, and on and on and on. I don't think I need to read the entire ruling here, but I think you can see why we say it's severe forms of autism. Our staff in each region will review the documentation that you submit when you're applying for eligibility under autism. And our staff will have this rule next to them. And that's why we're saying we need to look at the totality of the information that you're providing. We can't just look at one piece of document to see that they meet all of this criteria. Typically, when you're applying for services, you've been through the education system, they've been through therapy, they've been through multiple professionals, and you should be able to gather all that information and submit it for review. So we need to look at, again, at everything, and then be able to make a determination of eligibility. This is really specific, and I want you to know that our staff really you know, they want the best interest of the individual. If you meet the eligibility criteria, they will make you eligible. So again, it's just really important that we get all the documentation that you possibly have. And in the event that you don't have what we need, the agency will pay for one of those standardized tests to obtain a diagnosis. Yes.
I just have one question. I work with a mini Is there somewhere that I can get that to you? Is it online?
It is online in the Florida Administrative Code 65G.4.
Oh, yeah, what?
You can Google it. It's actually pretty easy. Florida Administrative Code, and then the whole Florida Administrative Code website will come up.
And he was super advanced.
Diagnosis of cerebral palsy and autism, or Down syndrome and autism, or, you know, it may be that under the autism they don't meet the rule criteria, but they meet it under Down syndrome, they're eligible. So all they have to meet is, you know, the criteria for one of them and be eligible. Yes, sir.
Yeah, that what you read a moment ago, that part of that, that helps me a lot. Because for me, you know, autism, until a couple years ago, it was a work. Yeah, I knew there's something, but I don't know. So that's why I guess they call it a spectrum, a very wide range of disabilities. So I guess what I'm going to say is I'm going to hope my kid doesn't actually meet those criteria. Because when you say, you know, IQ of 70 or less, that's pretty low IQ. I mean, exceptionally low IQ. Guessing that someone who claims that they were, or they are autistic, like Elon Musk, doesn't meet these criteria.
Oh, my goodness.
So, you know, and the answer doesn't need your support. And that's, I guess, your category of my kids. So thanks for clarifying that.
Yeah, when you guys go look at this rule criteria, you're going to see, to make this very short, and then we're going to move on, because we got to get through this, and because our director's presenting at 11, we have to be in that room, so I'm sorry to push through, and we want to get you all this information. But to make this really compact about the autism rule. Under this, for the severity, as he was saying, we serve children and adults that are on the severe end of the spectrum.
Okay.
And when you look at our rule criteria, there are two subparts
agility class back
of these criteria that Liesl was just reading, and there's a total of 12 criteria. And our rule says that the person has to meet at least 6 out of these subparts. And they're divided into subpart section 1 and subpart section 2, a total of 12, and they have to meet 6 out of those groupings, and one has to come from at least part 2, at least one. So, again, those criteria are very, very specific, and you have to have evidence showing in that conversation. So anyway, let's move along.
So now we're going back to slide 17. No, I'm sorry.
We're on spina bifida. So we need, we're going to have medical documentation for spina bifida. That's one of our developmental disabilities that we serve. We've got to have a medical diagnosis of spina bifida cystica, a myelomeningitis, something said earlier perfectly. The diagnosis, again, is going to be made by a medical doctor, a doctor of osteopathy, or whatever medical record you can give us that show the manifestation of this diagnosis prior to the age of 18. Specifically, individuals who have the diagnosis of spina bifida occulta are not eligible for APD services. Then we've got a disability that we serve called Down syndrome, and Liesl, and I'm sure you have all heard of that. And Liesl will talk about that.
So for Down syndrome, you probably have all heard about individuals with Down Down syndrome is caused by presence of an extra chromosome, 21. And we require medical records documenting a chromosome analysis, a diagnosis from a healthcare provider certifying the physical signs of the syndrome or prenatal diagnostic test. So a lot of people come to us and say, I don't have a chromosome analysis. It's okay, you don't have to. If you have it, then please submit it for we can always have a medical doctor certify the physical signs of the syndrome.
So even if it's not from the state,
Yes, that's what you have. Yeah, absolutely. The next disability that we serve is the newest disability that was added under our statute. It's called Phelan-McDermid syndrome. Very rare. In fact, right now there's less than 100 known cases in the state of Florida. Generally, it's characterized by these characteristics: low muscle tone, absent to severely delayed speech, and moderate to very profound intellectual disabilities. This is done, how do we determine that the person has this? Through genetic testing. So we'll need evidence of the genetic test to have Phelan-McDermid syndrome.
So individuals with Prader-Willi syndrome, this means an inherited condition typified by neonatal hypotonia with failure to thrive, hyperphagia, or an excessive drive to eat, which leads to obesity, usually by the age of 18 to 36 months of age. Typically, individuals with Prader-Willi syndrome will show mild to moderate intellectual disability, short stature, mild facial dysmorphism. And diagnosis is confirmed in writing by documentation from either a medical doctor, doctor of osteopathy, or medical records that document the diagnosis of Prader-Willi syndrome prior to the age of 18.
So earlier we talked about how soon can a person apply for services. Well, they can apply at any time, but we don't really look at people until they're at least age 3 years old. So I'm glad this lady over here brought that up about age. So children age 3 to 5 are looked at, and they're not actually put on the waiting list, but we categorize them and we put them in kind of like a holding pattern, a grouping called high risk, because they're on our high watch to see if, in other words, their condition is concerning, because it looks to the family and their physician like they might have a developmental delay and they might end up having an official diagnosis of a developmental disability. So these characteristics, we've got them on watch. There's been an application put in, and so what happens is at age 5, what we will then say to the family is, okay, please get from the physician a confirmed diagnosis of whatever the doctor thinks that the developmental disability, one of the ones that we've been naming, that the youth has. And then at that time, they will, once we get the medical confirmation, we will then add them to the waiting list.
All right, so the waiting list. We have over 35,000 individuals currently receiving services from the home community-based iBudget waiver services. Unfortunately, we don't have the funds necessary to serve the additional 22,000 who are on our waiting list. But individuals who meet the level of care criteria for an intermediate care facility are the individuals who would eventually meet the criteria for enrollment in our iBudget waiver. And if we can tell at the time that they apply for services that they meet that level of care criteria, then we place them on the waiting list in one of 7 priority categories. So they are placed on the waiting list by priorities. Individuals in category 1, these are going to be the individuals that meet the criteria for crisis waiver enrollment. And what does that mean? Somebody who's homeless, someone whose caregiver is unable to provide care to the individual, and the individual needs a caregiver. Otherwise, you know, their immediate health and safety is going to be at risk. And somebody whose behaviors are a risk to themselves and others. We're looking at individuals who have documentation of frequent baker acts, individuals who have either had to go themselves to the emergency room, or someone in a loved one has had to go to the emergency room because of their behaviors. Homeless individuals who are currently in a homeless shelter, or individuals who reside in a living setting that's unsafe, where there is abuse, neglect, or exploitation. We hear a lot of about individuals who have a developmental disability, who have resided in their home for years and years and years, and their parents have always taken good care of them, and all of a sudden the parent is disabled themselves for whatever reason. They're no longer able to take care of them. So we will review those crisis waiver enrollment, and if they meet one of those criteria, they will enroll on the waiver. So even though it's called waiting list, priority category one, they don't go on the waiting list. They go straight to the waiver. So they've been determined to meet that crisis criteria, we enroll them.
Yeah, I was gonna say, my son was put on this with AD, and his dad died at 9. That put me right on the waiver. Because I contacted, so you have to contact if you're on the waiver, if you lose a spouse, or when he becomes disabled, and you know, because I work full time. He was the caregiver. So I mean, make sure that you notify them.
That's a great point that you're bringing up. Individuals on the waiting list, anytime there's a change in circumstance, you should contact your local APD office right away. So you can update the situation in our system. And if you're currently in category 7 or 6, that's, as we will learn soon, that's for individuals who are either 21 or older or younger, but it needs to be updated to 1, 2, or 3, or 4, we need to do that. And we will tell you why in a minute as we get ladies to waiver offers.
The next category is category 2 for priority for enrollment from the waitlist to waiver. And these are kids that are involved with the DCF system. They have an open case, and they're either in foster care and they're transitioning out of the child welfare foster care system because they're being reunified with the parent. There's a guardianship being determine whether relative or non-relative, or there's an adoption in play, and or they're aging out, they're between 18 and 22, we call that the aging out group, and they need both this, they have developmental disability, let's know that, these kids all have a DD,
yeah.
And they need both the support services of APD and the extended foster care system, or, and the extended foster care, just as an FYI, is a voluntary program for these kids. Sometimes you do not want to take those services, but they need the support of APD, so we wrap around them and then support them through our program.
So we have just a few minutes. We're gonna have to rush through these, but you have the presentation and it tells you what each category is. For individuals in category 3 are the next people who are high risk. These would be people who are whose caregiver is expected to be unable to provide care within the next 12 months. That's different than somebody who's currently unable to provide care and should enroll via category 1. And so it just tells you people who are at substantial risk of incarceration, whose behavior or physical needs place them or the caregiver at risk. So we would place them in category 3.
Categories 4 is individuals whose caregivers are 70 years of age or older. Category 5, individuals who are expected to graduate within the next 12 months from secondary school and need support to continue with a meaningful day activity, maintain competitive employment, etc.
Category 6 is individuals ages 21 years of age and older who don't meet any of the other priority categories. And category 7 are individuals under the age of 21. So why is all this important? That's because,
Okay. So I budget waiver enrollment. Only the following persons that are able to enroll, only the following persons are able to enroll into our waiver that are on the waiting list. Those persons that meet the criteria that Liesl just described, danger to self or others, homeless, caregiver unable to give care, okay, we enroll those folks, then the community-based care youth, which is category 2 that I just described. And then we have a category where you probably heard about the governor and the legislature giving us funding to take individuals off the waiting list. This is a group of individuals that the agency looks at and determines based on their needs that they're critical and they need the support. These individuals are giving waiting list to waiver offers, and it was about 1,000 people-ish this last year. Then we also enroll dependents of active duty military service members, which is why I asked this gentleman, are you in the military? Because that's a key factor, because we know our veterans, we've got anybody who's a veteran, thank you for your service. Wives, spouses of veterans, thank you for your service. We recognize that is a need, and we want to definitely be proactive and collaborative. And then we have intermediate care facility transitions, also known as ICF, IDD transitions. ICFs, for anybody who doesn't know, just to tell them, that is a type of facility that's not a skilled nursing facility or a nursing home, and not a group home, not as least restrictive as a group home, but an intermediate in between the two we have, and those are for our individuals with developmental disabilities that meet the level of care to be in that type of facility. And then those people that have Phelan-McDermid syndrome, that because of the criteria that they meet, they also have immediate waiver enrollment.
So our budget waiver services, once somebody leaves the waiting list and begins receiving waiver services, the waiver services are those services that provide home and community support for an individual. So without these supports, an individual would otherwise be in an institution or an ICF, an intermediate care facility for persons with developmental disabilities. And our iBudget waiver program is funded both by federal and matching state dollars. Each state in the United States has their own waiver. That's why we were saying earlier, if somebody is receiving waiver services, say for instance in Massachusetts, and the family wants to transfer or move to Florida, they don't automatically transfer services. So you would have to request, similarly, if you're moving to another state, you would have to request, apply for the services, waiver services in a different state.
And when we have our individuals in the iBudget waiver, we want these services to be able to give them a meaningful day activity, whatever that looks like. And number one, and most importantly, we want them to have a safe place to live. We need them to be stable and safe and secure. Have a meaningful day activity, as I just mentioned. Every service that we determine needs to be medically necessary for them. We want them to have the supplies and the equipment that they need to live a healthy and stable life. And we also want them to have the transportation required to access their needed support and services.
All right, so we rushed through it. Yes.
Sorry we had to rush. We're sorry about that. And I think somebody else has to use the room anyway. We'll get kicked out. But here's our website. You had a question.
So theoretically, if possible, then, due to funding requirements for an individual to be on the waiting list and never receive services?
Hopefully not.
But it
I mean,
is possible.
Yes, theoretically, that is possible.
Okay, so they turn 18 and then they get, you know, not
yeah.
Well,
and when something changes, and Liesl said it perfectly, we know that things change in people's lives. Caregivers age, and some things happen to caregivers. I'm not trying to be negative, it's the reality. It's what we just went through. We're still going through, even though things are looking a little better. So it is critically important that these changes get reported to the counselor so that we can take a look at the case to see what can we do. Is there a crisis here? And we can review it.
Steve, so it's so good to see you.
The APD is the Category 7.
I was wondering if you were in the
show. He starts working and will APD, does APD provide transportation and whatnot? My one question was, it said in the description that there are services provided to people on the wait list.
There are services, and there's employment services.
Presentation I go to later, talk about that. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, but no. I'm glad you mentioned that. Individuals on the waiting list, we receive specific funding through the Employment Enhancement Project to help people who have a desire to work and have expressed that they want to work in the community, in an integrated community setting. So there are supports available for people who want to work.
Let me make one more comment too, and I see you have a question. And then we're going to close, and I'm going to meet with that gentleman as we're walking to our next thing. Anybody who has somebody under the age of 22 that they love and take care of and has a developmental disability or is Medicaid eligible, but specifically as it relates to developmental disabilities, you can apply for Medicaid, and you can receive services for your loved one under the AHCA, the Agency for Healthcare Administration's Medicaid state plan, if you meet the criteria for Medicaid for your loved one. They have a plethora of services, and I would encourage you, I'm not saying don't apply for APD, apply for us, but also go to all the supports and services under the Medicaid state plan, so you can get some support that you need. And then what happens is when the individual ages out at 22, hits 22, then if they're on our waiver, then we take over, because even if they were on our waiver right now, we don't really pay for much. It's all paid for under the Medicaid state plan when they're under 22. So I encourage you, regardless of what your status is with APD, if they have a child under 22, go to OCTA and try to get Medicaid and access to this service.